Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Are there any announcements for the good of the church?
Morning.
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 I've included wrist warmers into the repertoire of vectors. All proceeds go to that piece of cupboard. What you can do is do this. And then, like this. So, or you can wear the single. And like I said, all proceeds go to Becky's cup. There's only a couple downstairs, but I'm working on more. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any other announcements? Oh, go ahead.
Christmas Eve. Special music, so we'd like to contribute to the special music fund. It's a $200 fee that we print a restaurant check.
Are there any other announcements? Okay. I'll start in the front and work my way to the back.
Just to let you know that we will continue Lexio Divina at 9 o'clock. Sunday mornings. We had our first group this morning, and it's divine reading, which is a reflection on the reading for Sunday. So if you want to get up a little earlier than 10 o'clock, 10:15, we meet right over here in the quiet of the worship space. Thank you.
All right, Becky.
Just a quick reminder that, now I can say this, next week is our annual budget meeting with potluck directly after worship. If you have not received a copy in the mail, you should have, so if you'd like one and you didn't get it, let me know and I'll print you another copy in my office. So please come, we've got, there's some changes this year, and a couple things to discuss, so I hope to see you all after worship next Sunday. Thanks.
So Les.
Oh,
last but not least.
Okay, next Sunday I'll be collecting the gift card orders, and good news is that they do have some Visa cards. $50 and $100 Visa cards are available, so if you want them, just write them on the bottom. Okay? If anybody needs any explanations, let me know.
Coming days. God's people have always lived in great expectation, but that expectation finds specific, repeated enunciation in the texts appointed for these 4 weeks. The ancients anticipated a righteous branch to spring up for David. The Thessalonians awaited the coming of our Lord Jesus with all the saints. Jesus' contemporaries hope for the time to stand before the Son of Man. With them, we eagerly await the coming days, another Christmas celebration, a second coming, and the advent of Christ in word and supper. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who alone does wonders, who lifts up the lowly, who fills the hungry with good things. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the tender mercy of our God.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
A reading from Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days, and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Read responsibly some 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous.
Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths.
Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you have I trusted all the day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your steadfast love, and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord.
You are gracious and upright, O Lord. Therefore, you teach sinners in their way.
You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way.
All your acts, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies.
A reading from 1 Thessalonians. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy that we feel before our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you face to face and restore whatever is lacking in your faith. Now, may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love for you. And may he also strengthen your hearts in holiness, that you may be blameless before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all the saints. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Until all things have taken place.
Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard, so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly, like a trap, for it will come upon us all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
She persuaded an Inuit family to take her in and to keep her alive in exchange for her studying their behavior. Doesn't sound like a very fair trade. But in any event, they took her in and they kept her alive. And while they were doing so, Briggs was studying them, and she discovered that the Inuit have a remarkable ability to control their anger with one another, with each other as adults, and with their children. Even when it was justified, they never yelled at each other, and they never, ever yelled at their children. Miracles happen, people. because they viewed raising their voice as childish behavior. They also didn't do timeouts. Right? Because sending children away just reinforces the view to the child that there's something wrong with me. There's something unacceptable about me. And so when someone does something that I don't like, I can just disappear them. It's the premise for many a superhero movie. So they don't yell. They don't do timeouts. What exactly do they do? How do they discipline their children without these tried and true tools? They tell stories. For thousands of years, the Inuit have used storytelling as discipline. And so this is a quote from the article. These are oral stories passed down from one generation to the next, designed to sculpt kids' behaviors in the moment. Sometimes even save their lives. For example, how do you teach kids to stay away from the ocean when they could easily drown? Instead of yelling, "Don't go near the water," Inuit parents take a preemptive approach and tell kids a special story about what's inside the water. It's the sea monster. with a giant pouch on its back, just for little kids. If a child walks too close to the water, the monster will put you in his pouch, drag you down to the ocean, and adopt you out to another family. It's terrifying. It's terrifying, right? It's scary and it's strange. But it got your attention, didn't it? Well, I read this article a few months ago, and at the time we were dealing with some particularly fun behaviors from someone who will remain nameless because he is present in the room right now. And I know Julie and I were feeling like failures as parents because this child whom we adore more than anything in the whole world and would do anything for, problem number one perhaps, was acting out. And after exhausting all of our patience, it felt like yelling was the only tool in our toolbox. Just go to sleep! And then one day, Eli was hungry or tired or both. You never get hungry or tired, right, honey? And certainly not at the same time. And his behavior took a turn for the worse. And I said, so, just out of the blue, I'm going back, I'm like, how can I not yell right now? What can I do? That article I read on NPR. It's like, the sea monster's not gonna work with beer. And I looked at him, and he had, you know, Eli has these big, soulful eyes. So I looked at him, and I was like, have you ever heard the story of the eye monster? He's like in the middle of like about to throw something at somebody. And he's like, no. And I was like, oh yeah, the eye monster. Yeah, if you don't listen to your parents, the eye monster comes and takes your eyes. I didn't know it's better than yelling. Right? Maybe? I don't know. In any event, he listened. He stopped what he was doing, he listened, and he didn't do anything more destructive for the remainder of that evening. And it doesn't appear that it permanently scarred him. And he still talks about the eye monster. He has kind of incorporated that story into his story at this point. And for him, the eye monster isn't like terrifying. It's like a game for him. Everything is a game for children. So the eye monster's gonna come get me, mama. You know? But he loved the story, and it was fun to tell him the story, to create something on the spot. And now it's just part of our way of being. So the point is that when you leave here today, most likely you will remember that I told you a story about an eye monster who steals your eyes if you don't listen to your parents. Remember that, people. The eye monster is watching. But what I hope you actually take away from our time together is that stories are powerful tools. They are powerful tools. Made up stories about eye monsters, myths about flying horses and feats of strength, and the stories that we believe with all of our heart about God's love for us incarnate in Jesus Christ. I heard a statistic a couple weeks ago about the number one predictor of faith in adulthood, which is the reading of scripture in your home as a child or with the children in your lives. Children are more likely to practice their faith as adults if the people who love and care for them when they're children read and value and incorporate scripture into their lives. And I thought that was really interesting. Eye monsters are very attention-getting. But so is the story of Jonah running from his calling, and Samuel listening for God, and Paul converting from a violent and hateful man to a preacher of the love and forgiveness of Christ. These are the stories that feed our spirits when we're weary, and these are the stories that encourage us to go to the well of our faith when we find that our well has run dry. We gather in this way for worship. Do you ever wonder why we do the things we do? I spend an awful lot of time thinking about why we do the stuff that we do. And I spend an awful lot of time in church, as you may or may not know. So I think an awful lot about why we do this stuff. Why have we inherited this style of worship where a person stands up and speaks to us? This style of worship is from thousands of years ago when people gathered around fires to tell stories. This is the essence of what it is to be human, to share stories with each other, to learn from each other and be together and to grow together in community. We gather in this way for worship so that we can share our sacred stories, so that we can be encouraged to go out and share this amazing story with other people. But so what actually happens when we leave this place? I'm thinking about it this way, that Thanksgiving was 4 days ago now. And everywhere you look, I'm not gonna say, but it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. You can thank me for not singing later. We were driving around yesterday, and we lost count of how many cars had Christmas trees on their roofs. I don't want you to misinterpret what I'm saying. I don't want anybody who has their Christmas tree up already to feel guilty. We would have ours up already too if we didn't have 1,000 kids and 1,000 cats. But it's fine to be happy. It's fine to be in the spirit of Christmas. We were playing Christmas music all day on Thanksgiving. And I want to assure you that at least this Christmas, you get a special dispensation if you are in the Christmas spirit already, because we have suffered enough over these last 2 years. There has been enough suffering. Sing your Christmas carols, do your Christmas stuff. The point really is that don't just jump in to it. Be here too. Be in Advent too. We want to jump. There's that sense of urgency that we want to jump into the next thing. We want to jump into the thing that feels good. We're looking for that dopamine hit of Christmas. We want to jump into that warm, fuzzy story about the adorable, silent newborn. The adorable, silent newborn sleeping in a barn, peacefully, surrounded by gentle animals who very willingly share their hay. Right? Jenny, you know all about it. Give me a break. We want to skip over the part about a righteous branch springing up for David, the Son of Man coming on a cloud, and heaven and earth, the big one, heaven and earth passing away. We want to skip over all that stuff. We want to skip over the scary and the strange, the sea monsters and the eye monsters, the stuff that wakes us up from our sleep. the stuff that makes us reconsider our behavior. Why am I spending all this money on Christmas presents? Do I equate gifts with love? Love with gifts? It's the holiday season. Thanksgiving, Christmas. Why do I spend time with people who make me feel small? Because I feel obligated to? Maybe I'm going through a really hard thing right now, and I feel like I'm all alone. But because of the stories of my faith, I know that God won't let me be put to shame and won't let my enemies triumph over me. The kingdom of God is near, even when it feels so very far away. The purpose of Advent is to do the opposite of what our culture wants us to do. The purpose of Advent is to make us uncomfortable, to rock the boat that we've just been coasting along in. Just like our faith is supposed to stir up discomfort within us, to make us wonder, why are we doing this? Why do I keep doing this? Why am I going through the motions? When we let go of all the stuff of this world that we cling to, the stuff that numbs us, the stuff that hides who we really are and how we really feel from the people around us, when we turn to these sacred stories, our faith in Jesus Christ changes everything, whether you want it to change or not. We are Christians, and more specifically, we're Lutheran Christians, and we have this beautiful theology, the best. I'm not on commission to say that, but it is the best theology, of justification by grace through faith, that God loves each and every one of us not because of what we do, but because of what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. And the Lutheran tradition is a liturgical tradition. So we have these rich liturgical seasons. In some churches, believe it or not, there isn't an Advent. They do just jump right into Christmas. There is that temptation, really. We don't want to deal with all the watching and waiting. We just want to get to the baby in the manger. But we have this liturgical season. Our liturgy serves a purpose. This is a time set apart for us. A time out of time for us to watch and wait for the coming of Christ. It's not a denial of Christmas or of joy. It's just 4 weeks. It's just a short period of time where we are called to step outside of comfort, to wake up from our sleeping, to search our inner selves, our hearts and minds, to return to the stories of our faith and reincorporate those stories into our story. To be with Ruth and Naomi on the road. To be with Daniel in the lion's den. To be with David standing before Goliath. To be with Mary, waiting with Mary, standing before Gabriel. These stories, like today's gospel text, are frequently scary and strange, and that is absolutely intentional. These stories are meant to wake you up. So now that you're awake, how will you prepare yourself? How will you prepare your friends, your families, your church, the other communities to which you belong. How will you prepare during this Advent season? And a question, I think, for all time, not just for the season of Advent. How will you reveal the coming of the Son of Man? Amen.
Born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In this season of watching and waiting, let us pray for all people and places that yearn for God's presence.
God of presence and peace, strengthen your church around the globe to proclaim the message of your love coming to the world. Open our hearts to recognize your face in all people and in all of creation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of mighty redwoods and microscopic plants, fields and city parks, the wind and the waves, be a healing balm to our wounded planet. May we nurture what you have lovingly created. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of equity and compassion, bring righteousness and goodness to all peoples of the earth. Give a heart of discernment and integrity to lead us in our communities, local, state, and national government officials. May we encourage them in their pursuit of more equitable communities and hold them accountable. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of comfort and care, be present with those who watch and wait. Come to all who await births, deaths, divorces, new unions, new jobs, retirements, healing, and life transitions of every kind, especially the ones that are difficult for us to understand and comprehend. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of promises kept and new dreams, awaken. Shelter your people from destructive storms. We pray for those whose lives have been upended by national disasters, particularly the floods, the storms that we've been going through lately. For the work of Lutheran Disaster Response, Lutheran World Relief, and other relief organizations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of compassion and community, we give you thanks for the saints who journeyed with us and now abide in you. Even in distress and uncertainty, make us confident that your promise endures forever. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of new life, you come among us in the places we least expect. Receive these prayers and those of our hearts in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share a socially distanced sign of that peace now. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you all. service from all your people. Prepare the way before us as we meet you in this simple meal. Through Christ Jesus, our pathway and our peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new, in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your words take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth.
Come, Holy Spirit.
All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High, One God, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to Christ's banquet. Feast on God's gift of grace. You may be seated.
Thank you.
according to his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Most High God, you have come among us at this table. By the Spirit's power, form us to be bearers of your word, sharing gifts of mercy and grace with all. Through Christ Jesus, our Lord, our host and our guest.
Amen. Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak and help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And Almighty God, fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit through Christ Jesus, for whom we wait.
Amen.
Our sending hymn is number 244.